What's up? This is Mario, and welcome to Awesome Audio. In this video, we will talk about microphones.
Just like with speakers, there are many types of microphones whose characteristics make them useful in different applications. However, while the world of speakers is dominated by dynamic speakers, in microphones it is much easier to come across a variety of types. Microphones are a massively broad topic, so the information in this video will be very general and high level. There are different ways in which microphones can be classified, by its components, its frequency response, its directionality, the amplifier, etc. The first microphone contains carbon particles between its electrodes, one of them being the diaphragm on which the sound impacts. The carbon particles would behave as a resistor that connected both electrodes. When the diaphragm vibrated, this compressed the carbon particles, making the resistance vary. At the same time, this varied the electric current intensity, whose shape would be an approximation to the acoustic wave. This microphone is historical by now, since nowadays we use microphones that provide an output of much higher quality. The dynamic microphone will not be hard to understand, since the components that make it up are exactly the same as those that make up a dynamic speaker, only in the opposite order. Sound waves impact the diaphragm, transmitting the movement to a coil. A magnet passes through the center of the inductor, and the inductor's movement causes it to perceive the magnet's magnetic field as a varying magnetic field. This generates an electromotive force, described by the Maxwell-Faraday equation, that is, a voltage. Finally, the signal is the voltage measured in the terminals. A way of proving that the dynamic microphone and the dynamic speaker are practically equivalent is by connecting analog headphones to a microphone input and speaking on the diaphragm. The recording quality will not be good, since headphones are not optimized for recording voice, but the phenomenon happens nevertheless. These microphones are physically very resistant, which is why they are commonly used on stage. Ribbon microphones function under a similar principle. As a diaphragm, they use a magnetic ribbon, which is placed between the two poles of a magnet. The sound makes the magnetic ribbon vibrate, and the magnetic field fluctuations caused by the interaction between the vibrating ribbon and the magnet creates a voltage.
Before we proceed, I would like to quickly explain what is a capacitor.
A capacitor is an electronic component formed by two plates of conductive material, such as metal, separated a small distance by a dielectric material, that is, non-conductive, such as air or ceramic. When a voltage is applied on the plates, this places charges on the plates that are attracted to each other through the dielectric material, and that's when we say that the capacitor is charged. This looks a lot like a battery, doesn't it? That's right, between the two plates, there will be a voltage due to the charge difference between them. In a certain way, capacitors work like batteries, except they are generally used to charge and discharge many times in the lapse of a single second. As shown in the following formula, capacitance, that is, the ability of a capacitor to store charge, is inversely proportional to the separation distance between the plates. That is, the lesser the distance, the greater the capacitance. Condenser microphones, then, are microphones whose transductor component is a capacitor. Condenser is simply an old term for capacitor that apparently has remained in the world of music. The working principle is based that the sound waves will impact the diaphragm, which will be adhered to one of the capacitor's plates, and the vibration will be modifying the distance between the plates. At the same time, this modifies the capacitance as we observed in the formula, which causes charges and discharges in the capacitor, that is, an electric current. Condenser microphones are capable of producing high-quality recordings, since the components are lightweight and capable of moving faster and with more precision. A disadvantage is that these microphones require a power supply to work. Specifically, the voltage supply is required to charge the capacitor's plates and to power the integrated impedance converter, which we will explain a bit later. XLR connectors are usually used. Pin 1 is ground connection, and pins 2 and 3 connect to the power supply, which is usually 48 volts. The capacitor's vibration will produce a variation between these two terminals, and this fluctuation is our output signal. The good recording quality, the need for a power supply, and the fact that these microphones are more fragile than dynamic microphones, for example, make their main application to be in studio recording. Electret microphones are capacitor microphones that have a film of permanently charged material adhered to one of its plates, removing the need for a power supply. Because of the quantity and small size in which they can be produced, they are used in electronics such as cell phones and laptops. The components used and other factors in the microphone design will result in different frequency responses, so it is always necessary to use the appropriate microphone for the required frequency range. As I mentioned in episode 13, acoustic quality tests, a voice microphone will have a good response in the middle and high frequencies, but very poor in the lower frequencies, which is why it is a bad option to record a bass guitar or a kick drum. Directionality refers to how sound intensity is perceived when coming from different directions, and is represented with one of these graphs called polar patterns. These graphs are interpreted with the distance from the center to the curve in a certain direction. For example, an omnidirectional microphone perceives sound coming from any direction in a uniform manner, so its graph is such that the distance from the center to the curve is the same in any direction, that is, a circle. A unidirectional microphone mainly perceives sound coming from in front of it, which is why it will perceive sound coming from the sides with less intensity and would practically not perceive sound coming from behind. We can observe this by drawing lines from the center to different directions. There are various types of unidirectional microphones, and this one is especially called cardioid due to its hard shape. A bidirectional microphone will mainly perceive sound coming from in front of it and from behind, and would not detect sound coming from the sides. Ribbon microphones are naturally bidirectional, since they will perceive the sound that impacts any of the two faces of the ribbon, but would not be good at perceiving sound coming from a direction perpendicular to its edge. We should recall that, in a common room, sound reflects from the walls in all directions, so microphone directionality would not be really appreciated. This characteristic would be more clearly observed when the microphone is used in an anechoic chamber. Finally, microphones can also be identified by its amplifier. Due to the little energy stored in a capacitor, condenser microphones deliver a very low current signal, which is why, in order to produce a useful signal, an impedance converter is required. The impedance converter circuit will operate with an amplifier component such as a FET, which means field effect transistor, or a vacuum tube. So when we hear of a FET microphone or a tube microphone, we are actually referring to the amplifier component used in the impedance converter of a condenser microphone. With that, we conclude this episode. Soon, we will start talking about digital audio, which is why in the next episode we will talk exclusively about the binary number system. If you enjoyed this episode, you may hit like, leave a comment, or share to those interested. For more content like this, you may also subscribe. See you in the next video!